Okay. So, my name is Ola Spjuth. I will tell you a little bit about Sweden and how we use clouds and VMs in bioinformatics training. Of course, it's not going to be possible for me to cover entire Sweden because I don't know what everybody's doing. I know some. And I'm fairly close to the academic clouds we have in Sweden. That's sort of a disclaimer. I will not be able to cover everything, of course. So first, a little bit of background about what we do in bioinformatics and my daily job. So as I said previously, I'm researching halftime, but on halftime I'm heading the facility for data-intensive biology, bioinformatics, compute and storage. So in Sweden, we've gathered a lot of the platforms under the umbrella SciLife Lab. They've physically forced some people to move to the same buildings, which has been kind of nice. We have some resources, a few thousand cores, a few petabytes of storage. We manage quite a large bioinformatics software suite, reference genomes, data connections. More or less all of this is HPC, as it is now. Batch systems, shared systems, shared file systems. And it's free of charge currently. So I think this is an illuminating. Is there a laser pointer here? No. Whatever. We've seen in the last years quite a big increase in the number of projects that relate to biology. So this is a picture from the UPPMAX Supercomputer Center, and here we see the growth of all other disciplines and the growth of the number of projects that we have in data-intensive bioinformatics, I should say. Most of these are NGS related, because that's the big part. Here we go, something like that. Perfect. We also see the storage goes up, petabytes. This doesn't tell the whole story. This is just what we have near the compute clusters, and it's sort of only one part of it. Setting the scene in the number of projects, we have had last year 864 projects, whereas all HPC projects in Sweden were 675. So it says something about the magnitude of high-performance computing in biology, I think. The support tickets also tell that. We had about 7,000 issues last year. For a few hundred users, and the software suite here. Down here, you see all other fields in the number of software installations. They're virtually none, and the bioinformatics just goes up, and it takes, of course, a lot of time to do that. Since we talked about sensitive data, I thought I had this slide as well, and it also comes back to cloud. We focus a lot nowadays on how to manage sensitive data. We're building a new system, which will be based on OpenStack, which will be a virtualized environment where people log in, but we're still going to, it's going to look like a batch system, so they will still have a terminal and then a Slurm queue, because that's what users are used to. But in time, they will discover that there are advantages with having a cloud system as well, but most of them will not even know or see that they're running it, and that's perfectly fine with us. The main motivation for building a system like that is to provide virtualized environments so that a shared file system was considered to be unsafe. Data can leak between projects. If you isolate them in virtual networks, it is much more secure. Of course, it adds complexity. So now we have to learn a lot more about cloud. A lot of our HPC people didn't know that before. I know that Andreas visited CSC last week. Someone commented on this. He's the coordinator for the SSC, the Swedish Science Cloud. SNIC Science Cloud, it should be, actually, I think. Or Swedish Science Cloud. Okay, since SNIC is short for Swedish National Infrastructure for Computing, I guess we can let's say Swedish Science Cloud. I will bring back that later. We have three sites in Sweden. One in Uppsala, and one in Umeå. And they are joined together, forming SNIC Cloud, a shared identity store. So currently in SSC, there are 35 projects, over 100 users from a lot of different universities. These abbreviations are universities in Sweden and others. And life science dominates, but there's a lot of other types of things being run. And a lot of people are working on SaaS, PaaS, exploring big data analytics frameworks. We also run a mirror of Chipster and a Galaxy instance. But I think the Galaxy instance is scheduled for downtime because not so many people are using it. We've been trying, within this setting, we really wanted since several years to run Chipster, and I think we're finally able to do it on a level that we can accommodate for. So I think this is sort of one of the big beauties with having a cloud system here, that we can actually, with very minimal resources, actually provide a Chipster instance that people can benefit from at our state. So I think it's very pretty appreciated. Here are some courses. This presentation is about education. We give some courses that are very relevant for that are using, for example, SNCC Science Cloud, the large data sets for scientific applications. I will go in a little bit details in this. Applied cloud computing. Last year, a gene expression course using Chipster was run at Karolinska Institutet. AI kindly visited us last year and held a tutorial on Chipster that run on cloud. And I'm largely involved in a phenomenal Horizon 2020 project where we work a lot on microservices and we make heavy use of SNCC Science Cloud and Google Cloud. I will not talk so much about that here, but if you're interested, I'd of course love to share my experiences on that and how we use Docker containers, Mesosphere, Kubernetes, to sort of build up virtual research environment for scientists. But today we talk about training. Forgot that. So one of the courses is the large data sets for scientific computing. It's at Uppsala University, and it really covers focuses on the data management and data processing parts. They are exposed to labs on cloud computing, Hadoop basics. There's a MapReduce session, and there's also a Spark component. I'm mostly involved in the Spark part, and we use notebooks, Jupyter notebooks, to access that. So the motivations for this was that in order to provide these students with an environment that they could work in, we really needed a cloud environment. It was not really feasible to do any other way. And it works out really nicely. And the students, they get to experiment a lot. And more or less, it's not, cloud computing is not prerequisite for the course, but a lot of the participants had that already from previous years, and it allowed them to be really flexible. I think this was a great success, this course, and they had some projects at the end that were really, really cool. We have internet-based courses. I must say that I'm involved in these courses, and they're not really using cloud in that sense, but they're using virtual machines, because these courses, they rely on us providing users sitting at home, because it's an internet-based course. And in previous years, we spent a lot of time on supporting them how to install software. And that was something we really, really would like to get away from. So we let's give them virtual machines, images instead. And we found that the burden moved to having to teach them to use VirtualBox on Windows and issues related to that. We still think that it's easier to do it that way than the other way around. So there are a few courses where we do that. We're talking to other courses also, and there's been some other people who sort of expressed interest in learning how to do this. So we have a lot of courses that run on HPC right now. As you saw, we have a lot of projects, a lot of users on NGS bioinformatics. And these courses are currently, when we do these courses, they submit batch jobs to the compute cluster, the HPC cluster. I think this is very good in one way. You get to, you're exposed to a live environment. You really see your long queue. It's not faked. And you understand sort of that, yes, you will have to wait for your large job before it will run. And it's not imminent. And it's kind of good in that sense. What's not good is that there have been times where courses coincide with maintenance, scheduled maintenance, and sometimes there have been unscheduled maintenances as well. And it's not so fun if the file system is unresponsive in a course. It affects a lot of people at the same time. Maybe if you work, you can take an hour off and do some documentation or something else. But if you're in a course, you don't want that to happen. So we are right now investigating if and sort of trying to get the resources to provide backups for our HPC courses to run on cloud. And since we in Sweden, the Swedish Science Cloud, which we primarily will use, is not production grade. It's in developmental phase right now. We hope it will be production grade next year. But I mean, here you're fortunate to have CPOT as a production system. And that's something you can rely much more on. So I would really prefer to have these courses as portable as possible so that we can spin them up on our local private OpenStack and on Amazon, Google, or maybe, you know, in a collaboration with the CAC, that would be possible too. I mean, an additional benefit of this is that after the courses in HPC, we terminate their accounts. They shouldn't be able to log into the system. They are live systems, so the users cannot really experiment then. But if we had it in virtualized environments, they could still go back and rerun it later. There's a lot of interest in this at Scilab Lab, but it's also a matter of resources. And the question, something needs to happen before people really prioritize, I think. So an unscheduled maintenance at the right time would probably increase the resources I would have to move some of the courses to an HPC or create the backup anyway. So I'm very, very fond of Jupyter and notebooks. If you haven't used it, I think most people here have used Jupyter. It's been mentioned so many times. So sort of is there anybody who's new to the term Jupyter notebooks, IPython notebooks? Well, a few hands. So it's sort of these are really, I try to grab it in this way. It's really a mix of human-readable documents and executable documents. So you can learn and you can code inline from your web browser. And basically they have a lot of different kernels. The project was called IPython from the beginning, and it was later termed Jupyter because it was not really only Python. They have a lot of different kernels that they can execute. This means you can start a notebook in Python, and you can start another notebook in R, and another notebook in Scala, and it looks the same, but they will execute on different kernels underneath. And it really looks like this point where you can actually embed your code, and you can click on run as you saw there, and you can do plots interactively, and you can share URLs and work jointly and this. But in my opinion, it's a very beautiful way of giving users the ability to code in a certain programming language, scripting language, without having to install anything, but you point your browser to something. And we're facing the trouble with starting a new R and Python course right now. For quite newbie students, it's in the pharmacy school of pharmacy for pharmaceutical modeling. And how can we provide them with the resources so that they can code on their free time and do the exercises? Not everybody has laptops. Most people can get access to a computer, but maybe the computer you get access to, they don't have RStudio or Python installed, and maybe you don't have permissions, these kind of things. So we want to take that away. And I think this is a really good thing. We've used it previously for teaching Spark. It worked very well. And users, they submit these in the end. This is a file underneath. They submit it, and we can correct it. Yes, question?
Yes, I have a computer, and I have a lot of the range. And I have now an open source, for example, I think in MATLAB or something, it's now an open source program. And the other one, how you can version your code if you're using it.
Yeah. Well, two good questions. I'm not sure I can provide an answer to either of them. Regarding the underlying, that there are kernels for MATLAB, I think, and I think if you start this up, you would require a license, a server license of MATLAB, and I guess you will not be able to share that publicly. But I can ask the question to out here. Has anybody run MATLAB in Jupyter Notebooks or seen it? No. Sorry. No. Cannot answer that. We're mostly into R. We try to stay away as possible from these commercial solutions. Yes.
Switching to scikit.
Yeah. Scikit learning. Yeah. I think it's
because of the licensing cost and
just the. You have, I guess you have Octave as well. You can run quite a lot of MATLAB, but it's not 100%. I know there's a lot of, we're facing some problems also in, for example, in the Phenomenal project, there are people who have a lot of legacy MATLAB code, and they would, even if they would like to make it open source, they can't. I mean, it's MATLAB, so they have to rewrite a lot in that sense. That's sort of, it's a burden to do that. The second about versioning, I don't think that Jupyter itself handles versioning. Correct me if I'm wrong. It's not, and it's also not like Google Docs, so that if you type something, it will immediately appear with someone else. It's not like Databricks who do this commercial solution. Of course. Yeah, that's what people do.
You can view it also.
Yes. Yes. So, I mean, this is a file. And now here you have it in an executable fashion. If you put this file on GitHub, it will render it, but you cannot click run on it. But it will render it, and you can handle it with another version control system. But from inside of here, if you make a change and then you delete it, it will be deleted. Yep.
And there is something called checkpoints. So you can say a version of checkpoint, you can return to a poor man's solution.
Excellent. We got that sorted out. I really like this as a teaching, a way of teaching. It's excellent for online teaching material. That's where it excels, of course, where you're able to put these up. And you have so many notebooks where you can learn bioinformatics, amongst others. So they're very rich online resources that you can do and code in your favorite language and do whatever. I just did a Google search yesterday, and there's quite some substantial resources for that. But we want to do it for campus courses. We did this already, I mentioned, for the LDAS course. We had access to Spark environments. I think this Pouta blueprints. You shouldn't say Pouta. Pouta.
Pouta.
Pouta. Yeah, I need to learn this. Pouta.
We'll rename it to another
way. Yes, I think that would be good. And students handed in their assignments as notebooks, and we could run them. It worked relatively well. A bit of overhead, of course, in when receiving files and so on, a lot of students. But I think that the general impression was that we were happy with it. And we were of course, a bit afraid that this would not scale. We had 60 students. So a lot was, how do we sort of manage the virtual clusters for these people? It worked out relatively well, but we had some skilled people working on this. And now we're setting up a new, or I'm involved in the setup of a new course, though, and we plan to use Jupyter for environments for this. I really would like to improve on how we do these assignments, because that's when you do campus courses, it's all about the assignments. And Pouta blueprints sounds like a very nice front end to do that. So let's see where we can take that together. When it comes to provisioning virtual infrastructures, we use a framework called Mantle. I talked to some people here. I guess I would compare it to OpenShift without really knowing what OpenShift is, but I think it has similar features. It really wraps around a lot of other tools. It uses a lot of Terraform to define the infrastructure. You set what kind of compute nodes you want, the storage, the network, the DNS. This firewall it can be rather complex to do it, unless you do it. But if someone else has done it, you have your script. It's very hard to change 5 workers to 50. And it will update it. So it's like the previous Ansible script in that you don't write it from scratch. You edit someone else's and you possibly change a parameter here and there. We work a lot on Dockers in various ways, in Kubernetes, Mesosphere. And it's kind of nice because we can deploy it to OpenStack, to Google, to Amazon. That sort of, it's sorted out by Mantle and Terraform and Ansible under the hood. We don't need to learn that. So we use that to spin up our virtual infrastructures for the students. So we can say, do these 50 environments, so they should have 4 working nodes each and so on. And here's generated URLs for them on this form. And we can DNS it so the URLs can be actually really nice also. Traffic is it's a service that they run that controls. It sort of maps from the outside world to the inside worlds in terms of I think you call it service discovery. I'm not an expert in it, but it's a service that you run on top of it, so that you can. I'm pretty sure that you would manage the connection from outside world to inside world in terms of how do you find locate your services. Yes, question. You're asking a difficult question right now. This was the first time we did it, and we experimented with a few different solutions at the end. It was a bit hard-coded in this first time. We gathered a lot of experience. But if you're really interested in it, I will put you in contact with my PhD student, Marco, who had the final touch on it, and he will happily share how we did it. I think that the ideal way would be to use the Pauta blueprints, but incorporate our Mantle thing underneath it. Sure,
so
sure, if I can.
Oh,
one more time.
You are the one creating the document. You can't get like threatened to say, okay, here's my course, I've read the device, the thing for you, just fire up.
No, I think that at this stage we created the class, the compute cluster, because it's a matter of resources as well. And if you have 50 students and they all should have a Spark cluster, it's sort of kind of limited. We don't allow them to experiment that much on that side. But also on the other course, the large dataset course, people also used Spark and other things. And then this is the same course, but it's on the previous. Then they would use the dashboard, and they would fire up their virtual machines themselves. So it's sort of, you can have it a bit both ways. I'm actually a little bit uncertain towards what was the end product. We tested so many things, which was easiest. I think it's better let's go to the source if you're interested in that. But we focused a lot on Mantle. And we're getting some momentum together with other projects and our EU project as well. And we're quite happy with it. So I would really like to sort of hear if other people are using it. And if people are not, then we'll be happy to sort of explore what we have done with it and so on. And working with containers inside of an orchestration framework. In the EU project, we're using in Metabolomics, but of course, it's not limited to that, so we want to connect. I would really like to connect this with other tools as well. So everybody has catalogs. So we also have a catalog. So this was built. I mean, I think it was 2-3 years ago, something like that. We started a catalog of virtual machine images. This was a bit before Docker really took off as a virtual appliance, I guess is the most useful name in that sense. There was a problem defined in the FP7 All-Bio that it was difficult to find the VMIs. There were a lot of people who also, I think, who had the course. Yeah, I think it was you had a saying that it could be difficult to share them because they are large and they require bandwidth and so on. So we helped to host some virtual machines from partners, and we said, well, we should have a catalog to add to them. So we developed this, bioin.org, offers some free services to host images, and you have some you can register and handle versioning and so on. We published this last year. This is more what it looks like, and you can click yourself down, find out. We haven't really, after we did it, it was on quite back. Suddenly we saw these catalogs popping up every here, pop, 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 and there was UPPDB, and there were other, and containers took off and so on. So it's sort of, I don't think that it's, I don't really see it as, you know, the solution to everything. But at the time being, it was a nice place for us to provision our virtual machines to this. Nowadays, when we build them with Jenkins and automated build scripts with Packer and so on, we're still at the problem of trusting virtual machines and making them interoperable. And I don't think we've resolved it yet in the community. And the question is where it will head. I mean, I'm not an expert in this. Some people here I know are more experts than I am. But I think there's a stub here that could be used as a basis if you would like to have some sort of registry that has all the features you need to log in. And I think that the best thing about this is that we're able to host with fast bandwidth and backed by large storage a lot of versions for gigabyte-sized images. Yeah, that one is, but I guess you can scroll down a little bit. That one, we were using that image, it hasn't changed since in that sense. Discussion topics. How do others use virtualized environments in teaching? We've seen it already. I would really like to hear more. I like Jupyter, but it's not the only thing. RStudio, I think, it looked extremely nice, as is what shown previously in Ota Blueprint, or whatever it will be renamed to.
We're still taking suggestions.
Yeah. I can come up with many if you, apart from Ota. But one thing that I would be particularly interested in, how people have other experience with Jupyter and IPython notebooks. How many people have run these Jupyter notebooks in the educational for educational purposes? Somewhat, yeah, there are some people here, and I would be really interested in how you find it, what worked well and what did not work so well. I believe in it quite a lot, but it would be kind of good to understand the limitations before we put too much effort in it. So if you have any, right now, do you have any sort of things that you think did not work as well? Everything worked well? Okay, I'm going to finish up here. I mean, it's sort of, unfortunately, I will be leaving this evening, I think I'm going to, but if you have any sort of more questions or something, I mean, I'd be happy to discuss more around this. So, and thanks a lot to AIA for inviting me here. So, thanks.